God reigns. Oh, God reigns forever. Your kingdom reigns. Yes, oh, God reigns. Oh, God reigns. Come on, this is truth, let's prophesy. Yes, our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns forever. Your kingdom reigns. Yes, our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Good evening. We had a good morning here this morning. He made it back. That's good. Thank you, Lord. If you want to stand, we're going to get started. He's faithful. This morning we did a fun song, a newer song. So this is how I fight my battles. And you know what? No matter what we're going through, we can praise to the other side. We can lift our voice and we can declare the truth. Sing praise to His name. And it starts to change the atmosphere. It starts to change our situation. So let's praise on through to the other side tonight. Yeah, you turn old.
You turn my tears of sadness into such joy and gladness. My heart can't keep it in. I'm shouting, shouting. You turn my tears.
me look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Give me look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded. This is how I fight my battles. 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 Yeah. Open a praise, Lord. Till I get the breakthrough. You may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. You may look like I'm surrounded, I'm surrounded by you. You may look like I'm surrounded by you. You may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
For me every day, your love never fails.
Your love never is, never has, never will.
star we can't live without. Jesus, we love you. We can't get enough. All this is for you.
Thank you, Lord. Yaraba Santa Yaraba. Gloria to no mortificatori era la bon. Lebre dei divini. Manasse lebre dei viviamo. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia. Glory to God. Lord Jesus. 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 We love you. Can't get enough.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. We love you tonight, Jesus. We love you tonight, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. This is when we should speak up, when we're telling Jesus how much we love him. It's not about the song. It's about who we love and who we worship. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We're thankful, God, for what you have done. We're thankful, God, that you looked upon us and you sent forth your Son, because we needed life. We needed forgiveness. We were a dying people. But God, you had mercy and grace upon us, and you sent your Son. And in his obedience to you, O God, and in his love to you, O God, he died for us. But God, why can't we worship him tonight? Why can't we stretch forth our hands and sing that we love you, God? We love you, Jesus. It will never stop. It will never stop, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. We give you praise, O God. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. 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 We thank you. We thank you for your presence, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, that we can come and worship you. We thank you that there's freedom in the house tonight. We thank you that, God, when the enemy wants to press in like a flood, we can overcome those floods by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimonies. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you that you have overcome the powers of the enemy. We give you praise, oh God, in this house tonight. We give you praise because there's healing in the house. There's freedom in the house. Oh God, we give you praise tonight. We give you praise, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh God, we think of our shut-ins that couldn't make it tonight. think of Sister Leia. Lord, we think of Sister Maria. God, we thank you that your strength is upon them. And day by day, you are ministering to them. Lord, continue to pour in your health, oh God, into their bodies. Continue to pour in your healing blood throughout their bodies. We lift up Carolyn to you tonight. Heal her, oh God, of this lung infection, Jesus. Touch her body. Touch her body, Lord. Make her well. For the many in our midst, oh God, that we don't know that are sick. For those that have needs that are on our prayer sheets, Lord Jesus, you see every need. For those that are believing for household salvations, Lord, we call in those souls. We call them in. We call them into the house of God. We call them into the family of God. For those believing for employment, we know that you are the God who provides for all of our needs. And Lord, we believe for employment in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, as your word goes forth tonight, I pray that it will be your word. Your word, oh God, and it will pierce our hearts. And it will bring us to that place, oh God, before your throne. Jesus, we give you praise. Be with Pastor as he delivers the word. Let it be upon his lips fresh. Let it come freely and in power and in might. We thank you, Jesus. Be with the praise team. Lord, as they have poured out, and now they sit under your word, Lord, I pray that you would pour back into them. In the mighty name of Jesus, we give you praise. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Greet each other with a great big hug and kiss. And if those in our left wing over here are your right wing, if you can come join us in the center, that would be awesome. Praise God.
Amen. You're doing well tonight? Thank you, Lord. Eric, it's so good to see you. I'm glad you're here. Even though your parents aren't here, I'm glad you're on front row. Amen. Let's take one or two testimonies. It's family night. We usually do this on Wednesday, but There was one or two I wanted to just briefly share. Carolyn?
I don't know which one to pick. Yesterday, there was a couple that happened. So as you go, listen to the Holy Spirit. And yesterday, I was picking up a friend to go to dinner with a friend, passing the BGH, and God said, the Holy Spirit said, stop at Emerge first, hand out some books, and then go. And so we did. I thought I would just hand out a bunch of books and then be gone. But I ended up seeing a lady there. We prayed first and then approached the lady, prayed with her. I said, can I give you one of my books? She goes, you already did. I did? Where? At Metro. And I said, was it this one? She goes, no, it was a brown one. I was like, well, this one's green. And my story's in it. And she happened to be the lady that I spoke to 2 weeks ago. And it was the day before the flood. And she was the last person that I was to give a book to. I had one more book, and just on my way out, there she was. And I said, here, I've got a book for you. She goes, I'm homeless. My answer was, oh, that's okay. Here, take the book. And then I go back into my car. And then when I got into the car, Holy Spirit goes, really? That's okay? To the response of her being homeless. And so all week long, Holy Spirit was showing me, really? That's okay? It's like, I repent. I didn't know how to handle that. What should I have said? And then he goes, how about try, why are you homeless? And then take it from there as a matter of prayer. So anyways, that very woman was at the BGH last night, and I got to sow into her, pray with her, ask her, so why are you homeless? Because she said, I'm homeless again, right? And so anyways, that was just so amazing. When we listen to Holy Spirit, he has appointments. Like, what was the likelihood of seeing this woman ever again? And so I was able to bless her. We found out after we prayed with her, she was going to, after her time at BGH, they were going to allow her there for a few hours and then kick her out. She was going to go throw herself over the bridge. See, God knows. God knows the despair of people here in our city. And we've got hope. We've got the light. We're not a little light. We are the light. We are the lights, God's light in us. And he wants us to spread that to the hopeless. And he knows who they are. We don't have to figure that one out. We can't. But he just be obedient. And so I said, no, you don't need to go do that. You've got hope. And God gave me a vision for her. A bunch of children were surrounding her. I said, he wants you to pour into these children and give them hope. She goes, I love children. And I said, God knew that. Jesus knew that. That's why he sent us tonight to you. And so I gave her a bit of cash, gave her the book, gave her a hug, prayed for her. And totally, she goes, I'll hold on to that. So another life change, because Holy Spirit knows.
Sister Rashida.
I heard so many testimonies. Sister, you want me to call the Pakistan? Because I have so many of them.
Praise the God, our Lord. I have so many testimonies, but this is the new one. Just one day old. Last week, I got a phone call from Pakistan. In our village, we make a church, and there's the guy, he becoming a pastor. He's not a pastor yet. He just finished 1 year, 1 year more to go. His children get sick, like 2 weeks. He said his daughter's 4.5 years old. She got a big ball bump on her hip. And the 2.5-year-old, his son, same time, he have a little round thing, like a ball thing on his belly button near there. So he was, he called me and we was praying, and I just told him like some verses and put oil on it, anointing oil, and pray. So, and go check it with the doctor. So he go and check it with the doctor, and doctor say it's a hernia or something. I even don't know what is it. So they say they're gonna operation. Last Saturday, they was going to have an operation on both kids. But before that, what they do in Pakistan, people, they fast 24 hours. They don't drink no water. Even the little kids, 4 years old to up, they don't eat, they don't drink. I used to do that too when I was in Pakistan, when I was there. And later, even little kids, like 10 of them, they get up and they say they want to fast and pray for the kids. 24 hours from 6 o'clock afternoon to 6 o'clock next afternoon, they was fasting. And same time, I told that guy that we come here in the church and we pray. in the morning. And that day, Wednesday, me, Pastor, and Sue, we was just praying, and the Holy Spirit just like pouring. We was here like 2 hours, and we don't want to even go. We want more. And what happened? I finished praying, and she started praying, and she started praying for India and Pakistan, like people there. And I forgot about their name. And when she say India and Pakistan, the Holy Spirit remind me again, kids. I say, oh yeah. Then I hurry up and claim their healing and say their names and stuff. And then Saturday, the guy take her for operation, but the guy said that my kid's father, he told the doctor, make sure you do X-ray first before you go for operation, because he was standing with the faith that God gonna heal them. So the doctors, they go take them for X-ray, and they didn't find nothing. And they come home, praise God. And last night when I called, they was having a party. They was eating mitai and drinking tea and partying. And all the glory and honor to my God. I just want to say, prayer work. Doesn't matter wherever you are, you can pray and pray work. When God's people get together, like in Pakistan and here we was praying, God can hear and he can do things. Those kids, they cannot lie. 2 years old and 4 year old kids. Yes. And God be the glory. Amen.
Let's praise God for that. To God be the glory. Is that another one? Oh, there's another one. Pastor Ken. Last one.
I got a call this week from somebody I don't even remember. He and his wife used to come to our church in Montreal. They drove from Cowansville. And he phoned to say that one night he was in early prayer meeting on Sunday night, and I touched his hand or his shoulder and gave him a one-sentence word that God should set him free to his ministry. And he said that catapulted me into a ministry. I've been all over Britain, all over Europe, and I want to thank God that you were faithful to give me that word. And what I'm saying to you is, we don't need to say a lot or do a lot. We just need to be obedient.
Amen. Praise God. I need to say something before we take the offering, and it just inspired me yesterday when I was reading this book, and it says, there was a proud young man that came to a Greek philosopher, Socrates, asking for wisdom. And he walked up to him and said, oh, great Socrates, I come to you for wisdom. And Socrates, recognizing a pompous fool, when he saw one, led him down to the sea and took him chest deep into the water. Then he asked him, what did you say you wanted? Wisdom. Oh, great Socrates, said the young man. And Socrates put his hands, a strong hands, on the man's shoulders and pushed him under. 30 seconds later, Socrates let him up. What do you want? He asked again. Wisdom, the young man sputtered. Oh, great and wise Socrates. Socrates pushed him again under the water, and he kept doing that, and he was gasping for air. Between heavy breath, the fellow wheezed. Wisdom, oh, wise, wonderful Socrates. Jammed him into again, 40 seconds. What do you want? Air, the young man replied. I need air. And he said, when you want wisdom as much as you wanted air, then you will begin to find wisdom. And it reminds me that we've been praying for revival. We've been praying for a move of God in this church. We've been praying for something to happen. We want to see growth. Amen. We want to see these seats filled up. Not because we want big ministry, but we want to see souls saved. And if we are desperate to see revival, it's going to cost us something. And it's not much. It's just more time with the Holy Spirit. More time in your closet. I want to increase my prayer time. I want to increase my time with God. I have never sought the Lord as I'm seeking him in a broken hearted. And I say, God, you will revive this brokenness that I'm broken with. And I say, God, I thank you. Maybe I'm not desperate enough, but I'm telling you, begin to be desperate for God and you will see wonders. We heard this morning that God is the God of wonders. Amen. Fall on your face. Call on God. Be obedient to what he wants you to do. Amen. God bless you. I'm all excited because God has been doing great things in my life, and I see how faithful he is. Just come on up. Hallelujah. It's offering time. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I believe that God is doing something, and there's a tremor. You know, sometimes you feel tremors, and you know that something's going to break loose. Amen. Father, we thank you for tonight, Lord. This is an unusual night, Father, because we are standing before you, Father God. And Lord, we have full access to the throne room of the Father. And Lord, I thank you for the testimonies of miracles, oh God, of lives that are being changed, Father. And Lord, for the calling of God to be fulfilled in people's lives, Lord, I thank you. We want to see our young men prophesy. We want to see our young daughters on fire for God and his church. We want to see those in the cribs and those, Lord Jesus, in Sunday school begin to rise up and hear the voice of God as never before. We know that the word of God is his voice. And Father, we can speak over and over again, but when the Rhema word comes through, Father, Lord, you will begin to transform us into your own image. And we say thank you. Thank you for the faithfulness of your people as we give tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.
And Daniela, and these are your church announcements. 50 Plus is meeting Thursday, March 8th at 11:30 a.m.
March break, we are going to be having a kids cooking camp for children ages 10 and up. They're going to be having a really great time. John is going to be teaching them a lot of stuff about different meals that they can make and just helping each other baking. And then also we're going to be having a time of devotional before we start making the meals, and they even get to enjoy the meals when they're done. So it's going to be really fun, full week, 9:30 to 12 p.m. and it's going to be $30 for the Tuesday to Friday.
Men's breakfast will be on March 17th at 8:30 a.m. Movie night will be on March 18th at 6 p.m. Palm Sunday is March 25th.
We are going to be having a Good Friday service on Friday, March 30th, and it's going to be at 10:30 a.m. Also, that same day, we are going to be having a Youth and Young Adults Good Friday service, and that's going to be at 7:30 p.m. on the same Friday, March 30th. So you don't want to miss out on those two services. All are welcome. So this has been your church announcements. Have a blessed day.
Amen. We just, for you ladies that didn't register as yet for the One Heart, One Way conference, we want to encourage you to register as fast as you can. We want to fill up this place. It's going to be phenomenal with Laura Lynn Tyler Thompson coming from British Columbia. She's Canadian, but God is using her mightily. She's got our main speaker. As you know, she's on 700 Club. She's got her own also TV show, and she's willing to be here. And also Brooke Nichols, Kristen's sister. She's very anointed, and so it's going to be a great weekend. We have great stuff going on, and so we want you to don't miss the blessing. Whatever you do, don't miss the blessing.
Amen. I'm going to read for you Exodus 34, verse 10 to 17. Exodus. I'm sorry for my French. I need a translator. I know. That's why we're French. Amen. So Exodus 34, 10 to 17. And he said, "Behold, I make a covenant before all your people. I will do marvels such as have not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation, and all the people among whom you are shall see the work of the Lord. For it is an awesome thing that I will do with you. Observe what I command you this day. Behold, I am driving out from before you the Amorite and the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite." Thank you. "Take heed to yourself, lest you make a covenant with the inhabitant of the land where you are going, lest it be a snare in your midst. but you shall destroy their altars, break their sacred pillar, and cut down their wooden image. For you shall worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they play the harlot with their gods, and make sacrifice to their gods, and one of them invites you, and you eat of his sacrifice, and you take of his daughters for your sons, and his daughters play the harlot with their gods, and make your sons play the harlot with their gods. You shall make no mold gods for yourselves. And God, we bless you, and we praise your name for this night that we have, oh God. You are wonderful. And we praise you for those testimonies that we just heard. God, thank you that you are powerful and we can see that prayer works. From here to India, we can see that evangelism work. With a small track, someone can be saved. So God, tonight we know as we're about to hear your word, that your word also is powerful. There's no word that you send that comes back without result. So God, we pray and we know that your word that we'll send forth tonight will bring result into this church. Thank God for the fire of revival that we have tonight in this church, the fire of breakthrough. God, we want fire and breakthrough as much as we need hair. And God, we want this, oh God. So God, touch our heart tonight and let us be convicted by your word so we can be never the same again. We give you praise in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. It's good to hear those testimonies. It's encouraging to hear that. Praise God. Paul, we said it already in communication and this morning, but our love goes out to you in the absence of your mom. We know she's with the Lord, but may the Lord strengthen and comfort you at this time. And let us know when the funeral details have been ironed out. We'd love to be there to support you. Amen. Please show your love to Paul and Tabitha and the family. Their mother went to be with the Lord late last night. Thank God. And as I said to Eric, it's good to see Eric on front row. His parents are away. And so we're glad that he's, as a young man, here tonight. I remember when I was younger that we used to come to service Sunday night and just wait on God. And just, we loved the altar. You know, sometimes people criticize us for the altar and say, what are you doing again? An altar in every service? Well, Billy Graham was not a Pentecostal. He was a Southern Baptist, but I don't remember one of his crusades not having an altar call. Do you? There was always an opportunity, even if it was for one, to get right with God. Whatever the need is, that's why we're here. Amen. Tammy, I haven't forgotten. Tammy, him and I have been communicating, and so she's in touch with a ministry in Africa, and it's burdened on her heart to send clothing. So if you have good used clothing that you want to give from, I think it's ages up to 16 years old, boys and girls, summer stuff more so because of the African continent. Tammy, why don't you stand or wave your hand so people can identify you and they can pass those goodies along to you and we'll get them over. Thank God. One more announcement. It's a brother that we have met not too long ago. He says he has a word for the church. I haven't heard the word. He's come from Bethel in California and he wants to deliver a word this Wednesday, God willing. We'll hear that word and for our congregation. So anyhow, plug in. Hallelujah. This morning, as just echoed by the scripture that was just read, that God wants to do wonderful things in our midst. Amen. Because he's a covenant-making God, and he has told us to set ourselves apart And we have moved into the month of March, and it's really a reset of months because we are entering into the month of spiritual beginnings, spiritual renewal, spiritual new year. The Exodus is so clear that this was the beginning of months in the economy and establishing of God's purposes for his people. So I know many of you are praying and pressing in and consecrating yourself. And as you sanctify yourself to the Lord will do wonders. He has said that over and over again. We read it again tonight that the Lord says that, you know, he wants to do marvels such as not been done in all the earth. Do we believe that promise? We ought to go to prayer and say, God, you said this in your word. You said it. Is it real? Let it, these promises not fall on deaf ears. But may we pray them in. May we stain our Bibles with the tears of our humanity and say, God, make this alive in our generation. He said he would do marvels such as not been done in all the earth, nor any nation or any people among you whom you shall see the work of the Lord. For this is an awesome thing that I will do with you. With you and me. This is an awesome thing that God wants to do with you and with me. As we set ourselves apart, as we push back the remotes, as we push back the plate, as we push the other cumbrances in our lives and say, God, I'm pressing in. You see, someone's got to touch God. You remember the woman who touched God? We can touch God. Beloved, I don't have 3 points tonight. I'm going to share my heart, and maybe 5 points might come out. But what does it matter? As long as we touch God. That's why you're here, right? So picking up from the morning, as I said about the Presbyterians, when they would have communion seasons, they would set aside time. And they would just cultivate their hearts. They would break up fallow ground within their own hearts. They would examine their own hearts for 5 days before they even would go before the communion table. And they would press in and seek God. They would allow the word to melt them. They would allow the word to examine them. They would allow the preaching of the word to shine the light of truth upon them. You know, this week I listened to one sermon over 4 times. And every time the Holy Spirit highlighted something different. And I wasn't listening to sermons where I've already arrived in areas. I was listening to stuff that I need to grow in. So it would cut into me. So that when I come up here, I'm not just giving rhetoric, but I'm bringing redemption. And I think that's what we need in this hour. We need that old Presbyterian spirit of coming into communion seasons and setting aside days and fasting. And if it's 30 days or 10 days, you know, you choose your course. And coming under the banner and coming into the house and hearing the sound of the gospel. People draw near and they heard the preaching of the sound of the gospel. They had little in their day, and they did so much with the little they have, and we have so much, and we do so little with the much we have. We have the modern conveniences that life could afford that makes our life easier, and yet we are busier than ever doing what? Going where? You know what I mean? You don't have to wash your clothes with your hands and beat them over the rock. You don't have to wring dry like they used to in the old days.
You have fancy washing machines. You can air fluff stuff. You got stuff that mixes for you. You don't have to ring your, you don't need hours and hours of preparation. And yet we're busy. You know what? We're making excuses. We don't want God. We don't want God. We want this world. Let's be honest. They had so little, but they had God. It doesn't matter how many people show up tonight. What matters first is that God is here. If God isn't here, it doesn't matter if I'm here or you're here. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's what my heart bleeds. That God, you should be in our meetings. God, you should be burning within my heart. You should be working deep consecration in my appetites and in my attitudes. Oh, God, this is what I want to hear and I want to see. There's a man by the name of Robert Bruce in 1555. He was younger than John Knox, who I preached about this morning. He was like the William Wallace of his day. He had fervency of spirit. They would say in his generation that no man in his time spoke with such evidence and with such power like Robert Bruce. The Bible, they would say that the Spirit of God would fall in his simple preaching because he would spend countless hours before the throne room of grace. He would plead for the souls of men in his nation. And as a broken man, he would stand before the people and thunder the word of God with boldness. You know why men don't have boldness? Because they fear the faces of men. Because they've not been in the presence of the Almighty God. You know why men don't preach the whole counsel? They fear attendance and they fear the offering. I don't care about neither. God, bring me to that point. A story is recorded that King James of England would go and hear Bruce preach. And King James, of course, he was involved in dabbling into many things. And to avoid the conviction that was coming through the pulpit, he would begin to speak to his servants to push away the conviction of the Spirit. And the chatter in the room would get louder and louder to the point where Bruce would just stop preaching. And all eyes would go on the king and him speaking to his servants. And then the king would subside his chatter. And then again, Robert Bruce would begin to preach. And then again, the king would strike up another conversation to avoid the conviction. And then one day, Robert Bruce knew that his neck was on the line, but he could have cowered to the king, but he got up there. He said, "It would behoove kings and princes to heed the word when the Son of God is roaring through his scriptures." And when the king heard that, he silenced his mouth. You see, when he went before God, he said, "God, I don't want the king's favor. I don't need the favor of mere men. Please triple thy spirit upon me, so that I would preach fearlessly the whole counsel of God." When was the last time you heard preaching like that? Sure, we need to honor men. But when men contradict the word of God, we need to honor this king above every other king. Another time, you know, Robert Blair, a great orator from Glasgow, Scotland, came. And Robert Blair was preaching. And at the end of the sermon, he came to Bruce. And he came to Robert Bruce and he said, "Robert, what do you think about my message tonight?" And of course, Robert Bruce was not going to be give platitudes. He said, I find your sermons very polished, but there is no evidence of God or his power behind them. And you know, Robert Blair, instead of getting offended, began to sit under the ministry of Robert Bruce. And he began to admire this man of God who had the courage to tell him as he needed to hear, to bring him to a place of obedience to God rather than the fear of men. God, sanctify us. Sanctify yourself that the Lord would do mighty things. Get rid of the God. Bible says he wants to drive out these seven nations. God wants to drive out every enemy that is coming against you. God wants to drive out everything that is coming in your way as an obstacle. I want you to ask yourself, what is stealing the power of God in my life? A man came to me at the altar this morning and he said, I realize that there's certain people I have to forgive and go and reconcile with. They're eating up my heart. You following what I'm saying? There are certain things that are stealing our prayer lives, that are stealing our effectiveness, that are stealing the anointing because we allow the offense to get in. And these things are stony things that get into our heart. And Jeremiah said, go down. God, you know, Jeremiah was looking for a word from the Lord. And the Lord said, I'm going to give you a word. Go down to the potter's house in Jeremiah 18. And there, he said, there is a vessel that is marred. And he took that vessel and he took the stones out. And how many of us realize that we have stones in our heart that God needs to deal with? Stones of bitterness, stones of anger. Why do we get angry? Because things didn't turn out your way. You get angry at your wife. You get angry at your husband. You get angry because she didn't meet your expectations and serve you. He didn't meet your expectations and cover you and provide for you. You get angry. That hurt turns to anger. Then it turns to bitterness of soul. You see, sin becomes iniquity. Do you know what iniquity is? When it's settled in and it goes on generationally. That is a stronghold. When something has become iniquity in a family line, it is a stronghold. It changes the DNA of that person's makeup. It changes even their brain structure. It causes stones to be in their heart. My wife and a few other ladies with Tamara and others are studying the unoffendable heart. And I've been gleaning on some of her notes, and I think it's just wonderful what they're doing is cultivating a life of purity and holiness before God. Because God said in Ezekiel 36, what did he say? He said, I will sprinkle clean water upon you after I've gathered you from the nations and every country. I will do this and I'll wash you. Wouldn't you like to be under the washings of the Holy Spirit where he cleanses with that flow? And you shall be clean. And I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idolatry. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit within you. And my wife was telling me that, you know, if we have a new heart and if we have a new spirit, that new heart from God must not have offense in it. How can a new heart from God be offendable? I said, true. If God made that heart, and if it's not just manufactured by men, or religion or denomination, if God gave me a new heart, how can I entertain offense? Is that too lofty to imagine? Is that an unattainable goal? But God said, I'll give you a new heart. He'll take away the stones out of your heart, out of your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk. Oh, I want to walk as Jesus walked. As he is, so I want to be in this world, in my statutes, and keep my judgments to do them. Then you shall dwell in the land. Then I will give your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Isn't that beautiful? That's God's desire. To give, take away the stones of offense, of bitterness, of anger, of wrath out of our hearts so that God can give us a pureness. You know, I tell you, where there's purity, there's power. Where there's a presence of God, there's power. Moses was the meekest man on the face of the earth. Why was he meek? I'll tell you, because he dwelt in the glory of God. And God melted every stone out of his heart. And he changed him from the inside out. That's why he was glowing with the character of Christ. Amen? God's not looking to raise up new churches in the city. God's not looking to raise up new ministries necessarily in the city. What is God looking to do? He's looking to raise up bond slaves, bond servants of the Most High. We're looking to saddle a new horse and get on a new bandwagon. No, God is saying, where are my bond servants? Where are my doulosses who made covenant with me by sacrifice and by obedience and willingness of soul? They're surrendering themselves and say, Lord, here I am. Cleanse my lips. You know, James Calder, 1712 to 1775, his life is described. He said he gave himself to prayer. When you say give yourself to prayer, you know what you're saying? You give yourself to God. You're just surrendering. You're submitting. You're subordinate to God. He gave himself. He became so desperate to know Christ and him crucified. He said, as for me, I will give myself to prayer, as the psalmist said. He thirsted, like in Psalm 42. He said, as the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul pants for thee, O God. When shall I come and appear before him? He was looking for the next audience that he could go in the presence of the Almighty. When shall I come? Is that the longing of your soul? I'm looking for the next time that I have an hour with God. You know what I'm saying? That was his heartbeat in Psalm 63. You know, early will I seek thee. My soul will follow hard after thee. Not that I'll drag myself to church or drag myself to prayer. No, I'm going to get up and I'm going to be there pressing hard. I'm going to be the first one at the door. My soul follows hard after thee. Do you think when God sees a person like that, he's going to put him on the back burner? Oh, he'll put him on the wheel. He'll make him the man he ought to be. And listen to this from his journal. His journal, as he was petitioning God, he said, I was enabling this morning to say with humble boldness, Abba, Father. And soon my bonds were loosed. And my soul was brought into a large place where I experienced liberty and rest. The Spirit caused the north wind to awaken and command the breeze to blow upon my soul. And the spices began to blow out faith, love, and a Savior for the things above. Oh, to be tender. How little have I tasted of his love. How blessed be his name who has allowed me this much, and I would not trade it for 10,000 worlds. Is that your taste? Is that your experience? When you get up in the morning, early will I seek thee. Early will I seek thee. Every reformation started with early seekers of God. It's not just in time, it's in priority. It's a priority to meet with God before we meet with men. It's a priority to meet with God before I meet with business leaders. It's a priority to meet with God before I meet with anyone else. It's a priority with humble boldness, Abba, Father. Can you imagine coming into his presence and your bonds are loosed and your soul is brought into a larger place? Can you dream of that? I can see that. My soul escaping from the snare of the fowler, for the trappings of the day, from the schemes of the enemy, and where I experience liberty. I tell you, if you want liberty, when you get liberty from God, you have true rest. It's not a false peace. And then the Spirit of God blows upon you to awaken. You see, he desperately wanted to know the deep things of Christ. He wanted to know the deep things of Christ, and he wanted to see the ripening fruit of the Holy One producing, according to John 15, from his life. He had a soul craving that would not settle for anything less. If you believe in this inerrant authority, let me tell you, when God revives your soul, I wasn't going to go there tonight, but if he revives your soul, the five things that revive begins with a nation. It starts with a person. What would happen to you? The first thing that would happen is you would return to the authority of the Scriptures. The authority, the solemn, sovereign authority of the Word of God called the Bible over your life. Nothing else would eclipse that or precede that. It would be the sovereign authority of the Holy Scriptures, where the breath of the Spirit can illuminate and make alive to your soul, and you would walk in liberties like you've never known. Freedom like you've never known, not a band-aid. Belief in the centrality of the cross. I won't go there tonight. Those will take a little bit of time. But I want you to understand that tonight. When God is working on your soul, when God is working in your life, amen, he's driving out the enemies within our hearts. Why? Because as we read this morning, he will have no other gods. He's Yahweh. He's jealous by association. He will not share you with anyone else. He's not a fornicator. He's not an adulterer. He doesn't believe in multiple wives. He believes in one bride, and that's the church of Jesus Christ. That is his one bride, and he's jealous over you. He loves you with an unfathomable love, and he's made that covenant with you. Amen. Can you imagine if a revival hit our nation? Can you imagine if revival just hit our city, our region here? What would happen? If the Spirit of God hovered over us. You know, it talks about in Psalm 133, where there's unity of the Spirit. Where's the unity? And the Bible says that the oil of God would flow down that headship of Christ, where the Lord is that Lord of the church, and the Lord is the Lord of that people, that oil, would the anointing would flow over that church, over that people, and it would flow down them, and it would flow down their beards, and flow down, and the dew of heaven would pool at their feet. Heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. At the feet of God, his footstool would be the dew of heaven. You can't drive the dew away. How many have seen dew in the morning? You can't clean that dew off your lawn. It's settled there. That's what God wants to do. He wants to settle with his holy dew, the residue of his glory that flows down. Can you imagine the Bible returning to company boardrooms? Can you imagine the Spirit of God moving into the schools? Can you imagine the Spirit of God moving into legislative halls, moving down Park Road and Linden Road and down the marketplace to homes and West Brand over to Paris and different areas? Can you imagine the Spirit of God moving through people like you who know the authority and the source for all living is this Word of the living God? If revival hit our nation, people would have a new understanding of the work of the cross. They would understand, people would learn how much they deserve to die and go to hell. That's right. I deserve to die and go to hell. They would learn why Jesus went to that cross. That cross is not some gold chain hanging around your neck, beloved. That cross is a method of crucifixion of the most ugliest types, where Jesus died so that you and me would not go to hell. That cross is where God's mercy triumphs over his judgment. Yes, I deserve to die. But because he valued me and loved me and he died on his Christ on that cross, he gave me mercy. We're walking towards Good Friday. I can't wait till Good Friday to preach this message. I was reading, surely he has borne our griefs, carried our sorrows. He's carried your sorrows. Listen, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, afflicted. Did you hear that? Oh, you say the devil did it. No, the Bible says he was smitten by God. No, it was a Roman whip. No, he was smitten by God. No, it was the Pharisees who turned him in. No, he was smitten by God. No, it was Judas who betrayed him. No, he was smitten by God. Yeah, they're all pawns of the devil, but ultimately it was God's plan. That's why God took the blame. He was smitten by God. God could have prevented it, but he didn't. Why? So that he could save me and save you. He would go to a hell so I could go to heaven. So that cities could be transformed when people's lives are changed. He was smitten by God. He was wounded. The Bible says he was wounded for our sins, our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. There's an exchange going on here. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. He took chastisement. He gave us shalom. And by his stripes, we are healed. Can you imagine? I think Francis Frangipane talks about this verse, and he said, it was the woundings of Christ that brought our healing. Now, if you have to go through a trial and you get wounded or hurt, if you don't get bitter or angry or upset about it, do you think that maybe your woundings in Christ could bring someone else's healing? Isn't that what Paul said in Colossians? He said, that I may make up the sufferings of Christ that are lacking in this generation. What's the mystery behind that? He's talking about that we share in the sufferings of Christ, that I may know him not only in the power, but in his sufferings. Do you think that as his wounds brought my healing, that if you were to suffer as a righteous person, if you were to suffer unjustly, if you were to be jailed or falsely accused or falsely divorced or falsely hang in some way or the other, that somehow your willingness to submit as a lamb before its shears, keep silent, that God would see that. As Stephen said, Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. When Stephen prayed that prayer, who was saved? God heard that prayer, and he heard the prayer of Stephen and saved Saul of Tarsus, the ringleader who led that assault and stoning against him. You know, meekness is not weakness. There is strength. There's strength in meekness. Back in Israel, in the Middle East, in the military, they would train. They would train horses to obey their masters. And the voice of the rider, listen to me, they would put this horse in an enclosed fence area. And the master tells the horse to stand. And when the master tells the horse to stand, then what they do is they start setting off explosives all around that enclosed area. And they see if the horse is ready for the battle. If that horse reacts and runs and reacts at the sound of the explosives, then they know that war, that horse is not ready for war. But they will train that horse in that fence lot to obey the voice of the master, regardless of everything shaking and trembling and exploding all around them. And when that horse has learned the obedience to obey the voice of the master and to stand when everything else is shaking all around them, and when that horse doesn't flinch, they know that the rider is safe and he will not be bolted off. So when you go through the fiery trials, what do you think God is trying to do? Kill you? He may be trying to kill your flesh. What did Paul say? You know what Paul said? You know, the chief of sinners became the chief of apostles. How do you think that happened? It didn't happen overnight. You know, in that scripture close to where we read this morning, we read in that portion, I love the Apostle Paul. He said, we are ministers of Christ. You know, they used to, you know, don't think the apostle had it easy. They would say stuff like this about him. Oh, for his letters are weighty and powerful, but his presence is weak and his speech is contemptible. That means he wasn't a good preacher, a great orator, but he had conviction. They would say stuff like that, and it's in the Word. And then in chapter 11, you know what it says? He's talking about these who parade themselves as you know, big hyper-prosperity, hyper-faith people. He said, am I not a minister of Christ? I speak as a fool, I more, in labors more abundant, in stripes beyond measure, in prisons far more frequently, in depths often. He said, look at this. He said, from the Jews, I received 5 times, I received 40 stripes minus one. You know how many that is? That's 200 stripes less 5. He received 195 lashes on his back, on his body. That's the great chief of apostles. He said, 3 times I was beaten with rods. Oh, I cut my finger, it hurts. I can't get up at 5 o'clock. It's too early. Jesus said, can you not wait with me 1 hour? You haven't been beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and day in the deep. in the journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren. Is there enough perils there for you to fit into? He had every perils, not pearls, perils. But those perils made a pearl inside of him. Because he endured hardship. He said every soldier of Christ must endure hardship. Must persevere to the end. The testing of your faith produces gold. He said, on top of all of that, in weariness and toil and sleeplessness often, and hunger and in thirst and fastings and cold and nakedness, he didn't have a Learjet worth $60 million. He didn't have a $1 million house or a $20 million house. He didn't have the comforts of society, and yet he was a super apostle. Hunger and thirst. He said, I've learned in whatever state I am, whether I had much or little, I've learned to be content. I asked myself, where am I in light of all of this? Don't worry about you. I'm preaching to me. Nakedness. In other things, whatever comes upon me daily. He said, forget about my needs. And my, he goes, what comes upon me? He says, my deep concern for all the churches. While he was being buffeted from the outside, while he was being beaten on the outside. Yeah, the Bible says he was buffeted by Satan. That word in the original means beat. Why did God allow that? He said, while all of this was happening to me, he said, the care, the deep concern for all the churches that he had labored and birthed was upon my heart. He said, who's weak that I am not weak? He said, who's offended that I am not offended? Who's made to stumble and I don't burn with indignation against the one who made him stumble? That's what he's saying. He said, if I must boast, I will boast in the things concerning my infirmity. Do you boast in your infirmity? No, first thing we do is we get in the prayer line, give me healing. I'm not saying don't come for healing. Don't get me wrong. But you know, oftentimes we say to people, be strong. Be strong. And you know, sometimes I look at a person, I said, I can't tell that person to be strong. They're doing everything they can in their natural power to stand. But we should never tell someone to be strong. Because when it tells in Ephesians, it doesn't say be strong. It says be strong in the Lord. How do you be strong in the Lord? I'll tell you. How do you be strong in the Lord? Is you become weak. Did you hear me? How do you become strong in the Lord? You become weak. Weak. Why? Well, the answer is found in chapter 12. Listen to this. He said, I was exalted. I had a Satan messenger, Satan buffeting me. He said, I prayed 3 times. He said, the Lord said, my grace is sufficient. All sufficient grace. Look, my grace, my strength is made what? You know it, perfect in weakness. Would you allow God's strength to be made perfect? Would you allow that? Whatever you're going through, allow His strength to envelop you. Allow His grace to surround you in your weakness, in your pain. Let the pleasure of God so overwhelm you that you would have encounters of glory. Amen. What did he say? Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmity. I don't see people coming up here in the testimony line. I'm glorying in my infirmity. Do you see that? I'm glorying in my weakness. But that's what he said. That the strength of Christ and the grace of Christ can be perfected in me. That's how you become strong in the Lord, is when you resign. And when you resign, you're saying, I have a resolve to depend on a strength that is beyond a natural strength. I depend on a grace that is beyond a natural grace. Other men may have failed in this trial of their soul, in the trial of fire, but I will prove my God that when I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. And I will come forth pure than gold. Is that the gospel we want to believe? I tell you, if we live this gospel, this is the gospel of the cross. If we're willing to believe and embrace this gospel, you will be so radically impacted and changed that you will be a revolutionary wherever you go, because you will have the abundance of grace in your weakness, and you'll display the glory of Christ radiating from all over you. I know you're getting tired, so I'm going to close with this illustration. He had enough of reigning the ruler for two servants. There's a brother that we met. His name is Gerard Long. Let me see if I can find his photograph. I want to tell you this story. It's a true story. We have become to know each other a little bit more. We met them about 4 years ago. This is Gerard and Janine Long. We met them about 4 years ago in Mexico. Gerard was a banker with HSBC in London. He got promoted to the highest ranks. He traveled the world. He set up global initiatives. He was a well-to-do banker, settled then in New York. His wife was a ballerina. They made it to the pinnacle of success. They had encounters with God in the 80s. Then in the midst of all of their high points and stuff, they had a parent's nightmare. Their son, 17 years old, named Alex, committed suicide. And that led to intense brokenness. Janine lost her faith for a few years. Gerard says, apart from God's grace, their marriage would have failed. During that period, Gerard sought the Lord for revelation of eternity to help him through this terrible pain and suffering. The time that we met them in Mexico, we sat with them by the providence of God and their table, and they shared their story. Janine would have been much like that, broken, still not healed. Came out. Gerard had left HSBC banking. He was now leading Alpha. You know Alpha? He was the CEO of Alpha. And in his brokenness, we attempted and prayed and strengthened Janine at that time that we were there with them in Mexico. We had a chance to meet their daughter as well. And their daughter, that was Rebecca, that was with them. And she was going through some physical challenges, but she had the sweetest spirit about her. She had a real love for God, a real consecration. And she was a national youth director in Alpha. And just shortly after we met them in 2014, another tragedy struck their home. This beautiful daughter, Rebecca, slipped, and she fell into frigid waters of Lake Michigan. And while she was crying out, gasping for air, screaming out, many witnesses saw her. All they did was pick up a cell phone and call 911. But it was too late. No one jumped in to rescue. And he said, I was upset. Why didn't somebody jump in? Why didn't somebody throw lifelines? Why didn't somebody reach out to my daughter? He says, there's no way to describe our pain and our suffering in the midst of it. They had learned through all of this when Rebecca, we had prayed with Rebecca. We'd encouraged her, and then shortly after, she passed into eternity. Son gone to suicide, a daughter prematurely taken. God, what are you doing? God, what is this all about? He resigned from Alpha. But, you know, we met them again in Louisiana just a few weeks ago. And we sat again at their table for one of the sessions. And we began to pick up where we left off years ago. And we shared our condolences. You know, I said, we've been praying for you. We watched the funeral. You know, we've been following a little bit here and there about your loss. And you know, they were thankful for all of that. But there was a new radiance about them. There was a new radiance about Janine, who years ago was all traumatized and broken and was on the brink of giving up her faith even then. Gerard shares it, and then she shared it. She said, you know, I was on the brink of suicide. I was about to take my life. And as I was about to take my life in my room, Jesus showed up. Jesus walked into my room. And he spoke words of comfort to me. In my suffering, he healed me. And she said, I had an encounter with the living Jesus who wiped away all my tears and healed all my sorrow. Gerard got up for a few minutes and he shared with all of us at the end. He said, today, we should have been a statistic. Our marriage should have been done and over with. But for the grace of God, I stand here to testify that we are relaunching a ministry to help families and couples to go through crises and see Christ in the midst of it. That's the God's message of grace and glory. Yes, we got to pick up our cross to the valley of fiery trials. But that's not the end. Now they have a promotion from the Lord to go and touch communities and families. And you know, it was beautiful because we were praying for Canada in a session. Then we prayed for America. We prayed for Mexico and different parts of the world. And when they said, all the Canadians stand up, and there were just a few of us there representing Canada, Gerard came over to me and he put his hands on me, and others did too. But he prayed intensely into my spirit, and then he gave me a word. I said, this man could not have done this a few years ago. But I know that they had a genuine encounter because his wife's countenance had changed. He was reignited. He was flowing in the prophetic. He was flowing like with words that were admonitions and edification and building again because God had met him. That's where God wants to bring us. Not to defeat, but to heal us. So as the team comes back, can you glory in your tribulation until God brings you to that place of knowing him face to face? I don't know what God is doing because every trial, you know, we were having lunch with a brother and he said, we make custom-made furniture. We can change the legs, we can change the top, we can change the color. And I sat there, God makes custom-made trials so that we can triumph. No two trials are the same. Amen? I don't know what your marriage is going through. I don't know what your relationships are going through. But you must choose not to let stones come into your heart. An unoffendable heart. You must choose that God has given you a new heart. You must choose to be like that horse. If there's all these explosives going around from the enemy all around you, if the Lord says stand, then you will see the salvation of your God. You are not to be moved. Say, God, bring me to that place. God, bring me to that place. Does that minister to you tonight? That's what God wants to bring me and you and all of us if we are simply willing to allow even the fiery trials. Why? Because I'll tell you, there's only one fire that should be burning.
It's not the fires of hell or the fires of this world burning in our home, but it ought to be the fires of God. Burning within my soul, burning within my heart, burning within my home, burning within my church. The fires of the Almighty God. Amen. I mentioned this morning that George Ries sent me this article this morning about an area he knows well in Hamilton. Don't be like this, is all I'm saying. The mob who is dressed in black damaged stores and vehicles on Lockheed Street. How many heard about this? How many police spent Saturday evening on Lockheed Street investigating damages caused by about 30 individuals who were dressed in black, faces covered, walked around the streets carrying a banner saying, "We are the ungovernables." That's rebellion. We're not governed by no man. Yeah, you are. You're governed by another spirit. And they begin setting out fireworks and smoke bombs and damaging vehicles, throwing eggs and rocks on stores and homes. And people in restaurants were watching what's going on outside. Over $100,000 of damages were done. Just down the road. Let's stand if we're able. Let's come under the bridle of the Holy Spirit, shall we? As we prepare our hearts in this month and as we race towards Good Friday, maybe Pastor Ken, you could come and help me lead in a prayer. Open your hearts and say, "God, I'm not going to be offended. I want you to deal with all the stony things that I've got in my heart. Create in me a clean heart, O God." Just yield yourself to the Spirit tonight. Whatever trial you don't understand, He knows. He's sovereign. Holy Spirit, touch us tonight.
How many of you are going to go home tonight to people that don't love Jesus? How many of you are going to go into a workplace tomorrow with all kinds of people that don't love Jesus? You put your hand up. Would you put your other hand up and just say, "Jesus, fill me with yourself tonight. Help me to rise above the stuff around me, to rise into victory, to rise into power, to rise into your wisdom and into your knowledge and into the great sea of your assurance. Surround me, insulate me from the environment around me, and help me, O God, to be the vehicle through which you flow to a needy world." Now with your hands up, just begin to pray in the Holy Spirit. You don't need to shout, but just pray in the Holy Spirit. Let the tongue come through you, because the Holy Spirit knows what you need tomorrow, what you need in that home that you go back to where nobody loves Jesus. Oh God, fill us with yourself tonight. Fill us to the fullness, Lord. I don't know what it all means, but Paul, who was baptized with the Spirit, said that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. Fill us with that fullness. Enlarge the place of your dwelling, Lord God, that we may be filled with all the fullness of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Send me from this place, Lord, full of yourself. Not full of myself, but full of yourself, O God. Full of yourself, O Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's beautiful. Some of you are really drinking. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you.
And pray.
I'm going to invite you tonight, if there's any couple or if any soul, any individual here tonight that needs the ministry of the heart issues. Guard your heart, for out of there flow the issues of life. If there are things you're battling with and you said, just Pastor, hold my hand, or Sister Natalie, hold my hand, then we're here for you. And we'll pray you through. We'll press you forward. Don't leave here without the touch of God. Because when you touch Him, you'll get the draw that you need. You'll get the draw that you need, that you came for, and He'll touch you and He'll change you. Our prayer teams are here as well. So as they continue to minister, you're welcome to stay and linger in the presence of the Lord, or you're welcome to gently slip out and make your way to the cafe if you want to have some fellowship. But don't disturb the sanctuary area with chatter. Let's just sanctify this place. We want to dedicate this month. We want to dedicate this season to the Lord. God will multiply graces so that we can go in. Amen. So would you slip out of your chairs now and just come. And maybe some of our deacons or pastors would minister to Paul and Tabitha as well. And if others need ministry, just come. We want to minister words to you, minister life to you, minister His grace upon you. Just come on out. Just slip out. It's all right if you need a second touch. It's all right if you need a second dose. Jesus prayed twice for the man who needed healing. And the first time he got a little bit, then he came back and he got some more. And it was completed. The healing was completed. Praise God, amen. Stand in the gap for our city. Stand in the gap that the Spirit of God would move. Say you'll be a person of prayer this week. Say you'll change something. Say you'll make an effort, a concerted effort, to come out to one extra prayer meeting. You'll do it. You'll make a concerted effort to get up a half an hour earlier and just meet with your Maker. You don't have to meet with me. You don't have to meet with anyone else, but meet with your Maker. And taste of the goodness and the glory of God. Praise our God. Jesus. Yeah.
Like a
Jesus.
Oh, Exalted, he is exalted.